Okay, so it's a great pleasure to give this talk in honor of Alain Valette, who, as Claire just mentioned, you know, is a very brilliant student that I had at some point. And I mean, it's quite striking to notice the conjunction between Alain and IHUS, because they are both 60 this year. So, which means that they must have been born more or less at the same time.
In the same room.
In the same room. Yes, and also, I mean, it's quite striking that, you know, Alain has played a very important role in the administrative part of the Council of IHUS, and it's also quite striking to see that his mathematical inspiration is very, very close to few of, you know, the great people in IHUS, like Misha and so on. So, I mean, he has, you know, both this taste for geometry and analysis and so on that we all appreciate very much. So I will come back to that at the end. Okay, so today what I want to explain is quite simple. It's a joint paper with Shamseddin and Soilokom. And if you want, it's a strange thing because it is the fact that the spectral action, which I will explain, is in fact surprisingly related to entropy. But through this relation, so I can tell you right away what is the content, if you want, what is the main result. So the main fact is that through this link between the spectral action and the entropy, normally when one defines a spectral action, one uses an arbitrary test function. So, I mean, the spectral action is something which is defined for spectral triples, I will explain what it is, by some function of the operator D, which defines the metric. And a priori, the function f is like an arbitrary test function. But in the link with entropy, which I will explain, the function takes a very specific form. And what we were quite amazed by when we wrote this paper was that this function is in fact intimately related to the Riemann zeta function. So this came out as a total surprise. Okay, and so if you want, the motivation of all this work, which I have been doing with Shamseddin, Mukhanov and Soilokom and several people. The motivation came from the idea that it's probably a misconception to think that when we look at space or space-time, it is a continuum at any scale. And I mean, and the person that actually already said that from the very beginning is Riemann himself. What he said, when you look at his inaugural lecture on geometry, what he said is that if you take the notion of a solid body or of a ray of light on which he was basing, if you want, the Riemannian paradigm of ds squared equals g mu dx mu dx nu. So, I mean, so what he's saying is that in general, you cannot rely on this notion of solid body or of ray of light in the infinitely small, and in fact you have to be careful. And so what he says is that it's therefore quite conceivable that the metric relations in the very small do not conform to what he had set up as the hypothesis of geometry. And then he goes further actually, and he explains that in fact one should, if this is the case, one should look for the foundation as the forces, the binding forces, which if you want, rule the physics. And they should be involved in the geometry of, the basic geometry, if you want, the geometry of space or space-time. So in fact, it turns out that quantum mechanics forces you to take a paradigm for geometry which is more flexible than having a continuum and having the g mu dx mu dx nu locally and so on. And this paradigm took some time to reach, and it's a notion of spectral geometry. And spectral geometry is given by a triple, so you have three ingredients. Well, in fact, you have two ingredients which are in the middle, which are acting in the same space. This is Hilbert space, infinite dimensional countable basis. This is an algebra, okay? So it's an algebra, but which is acting as operators in this Hilbert space. And this guy, this D, is a symbol for the Dirac operator. This is what you have to keep in mind. But it will be, if you want, the inverse line element very soon. So it turns out that this notion of spectral geometry, it has three aspects. And it would be a mistake to take one of these aspects as being the main one, because each of them plays a role. So the first aspect is k-homology. And this aspect in k-homology is quite rooted in mathematics. And this means that when you consider, if you want, the data which is here, it has meaning because when you have a manifold, it's not just, you know, a space up to homotopy. It does characteristic classes like the Pontryagin classes, which are finer than just giving the space up to homotopy. And this wouldn't be seen if you take ordinary homology, but it is seen when you take k-homology. And essentially, this triple, the if you want that part, the k-homological part, gives you the fundamental class. Now, the second aspect is the metric aspect. And it turns out that in the metric aspect, if you want, instead of measuring distances by taking an arc between two points and taking the smallest length of the arc using the square root of d square, you do something different. And the fact that you do something different allows you to measure distances in spaces which are, for instance, totally disconnected, which don't have any arc. And but the distance gives you the same formula when you are dealing with an ordinary space. And the duality between the two formula is the Kantorovich type duality, which is familiar in the transport equation, transport of stuff, you know, like a monge and so on. So this is the metric aspect. The metric aspect is quite important because it will make sense in a non-commutative case as well. And finally, probably the topic that will be most important for today is the link with physics. So in the link with physics, what happens is that physicists in the quantum, they have what are called Feynman diagrams. And when you consider Feynman diagrams, which have to do with fermions, then there are things which relate two very close by points together. And this is the fermion propagator. And it turns out that in non-commutative geometry, with this spectral triple, sorry, this is really the line element. So it turns out that it fits with a lot of things. And we shall use this link with physics when we find the link with entropy. Okay, so I'll go very fast in the first part because this is not my point today. I want to explain the link with entropy. So I will go very fast just to tell you what is the framework, the general framework, just to survey the general framework. So as I said, you know, the notion of manifold is more delicate than just having Poincaré duality in ordinary homology. And this comes essentially from one result which is very striking, which is due to Sullivan, and which says that if you take a microbundle, so the microbundle will exist as soon as you have a space which has Poincaré duality in ordinary homology. If it's simply connected, put it in a usual Rn space, it has a normal bundle, but it's not a bundle, it's a microbundle. And if you could make this microbundle into a bundle, vector bundle, then you could use Thom transversality to make it into a manifold. But in general, you cannot. And what is missing is exactly what is needed for a microbundle to become a PL bundle, let's say, which in dimension 4 is the same thing, which is what is called the k-orientation. So this is the usual stuff. Now, this stuff is purely topological. And that stuff, which was purely topological, becomes now related to Hilbert space because of the work of Atiyah and Singer on index theory. So both Attia and Singer understood that there was an abstract way to formulate index theory, which was with abstract elliptic operators, which are acting in Hilbert space, okay? And then gradually, through the work of many people, Brown, Douglas, Fillmore, Voiculescu, and finally Kasparov, you know, with the Kasparov theory, it turned out that this allowed to reformulate the dual theory to K-theory, which is K-homology, in terms of Hilbert space. So this accounts, if you want, for the homological part, okay? So, I mean, one has a very simple dictionary. So in that dictionary, in the classical column, what you have is the usual Riemannian formulation. And what you have in the other column, in the quantum column, you have the translation in non-commutative geometry. But as I said, I mean, the main point is that now you have abstracted the idea of manifold, and you have also abstracted, I mean, you have also now the possibility to use an algebra which is no longer commutative. That makes a big, big difference. That gives you more freedom, okay? Now what turns out to be the case is that, the square of the line element, now we have been able to extract a square root. This extraction of square root is the extraction of the square root of the Laplacian, if you want, which replaces the Laplacian by the Dirac operator, okay? So that was fine, the extraction of the square root. But then, if you want, when you think about the general framework and you try to apply it to physics and so on, you wonder how can you understand, if you want, the role of the algebra A. Okay, it turns out that the way this role was unveiled, if you want, was by doing exactly the same thing for the position variables, namely for the coordinates, if you want, as the Dirac operator does for the momentum. So the Dirac operator, it assembles the momentum into a single thing, which is the Dirac operator. And in the same way, what we did with Shamsedi and Mukhanov was to assemble the position variable exactly in the same way, by a Feynman slash. So the Feynman slash means that you add, you put gamma matrices. You know, the idea is very simple. The idea is, for instance, instead of thinking of four coordinates, you can think of a single quaternion. That's very nice, because then you can manipulate with four coordinates as a single symbol, as a single element, okay? So the gamma matrices are exactly playing that role. And then it turned out that what we did was to understand a geometry as an irreducible representation. And an irreducible representation of what? You know, the simplest example of a spectral geometry is obtained by the circle of length 2 pi. How do you get the circle of length 2 pi out of an irreducible representation? Well, you consider the following thing. You consider a unitary operator, U, okay? And you look for the matrix. So the matrix is this D. You don't know what it is, but you write a presentation. You write an equation. And the equation that you write is U star D commutator U is equal to 1. Okay, this is a kind of Heisenberg commutation relation. You spell out the irreducible representations. It's not difficult. It's an exercise. Okay, because why is it an exercise? Because this is telling you that the operator of these two guys. This is a self-adjoint operator. And this is unitary. Okay, this is self-adjoint. Okay, now this self-adjoint operator will have a spectrum, but this spectrum has to be, if it's irreducible, it has to be the integers up to a shift. Why? Because d minus u d u star. I'm messing it up. So it's u star du minus d is equal to 1. So this u star du is equal to d plus 1. This means the spectrum has to be shift invariant by 1. So then you get easily the irreducible representations. And once you have these irreducible representations, you can compute the distance, the metric, and everything, and you get the ordinary circle, but with length 2 pi. Now, this is very simple. So this is what is written here. Okay, this is very simple. But what is much more interesting now, well, here you see in this example, the algebra was commutative because it was just a single unitary. Okay? Now, what is quite surprising and beautiful, is that you can get much more interesting algebras than the circle, I mean much more interesting spaces than the circle, but by doing the following. So now what you do is you take 2x2 matrices. So you take M2 of C, okay, and to this algebra now I add a punctuation symbol. By punctuation symbol I mean a Y which satisfies Y square equals 1 and Y equals Y star, so it's self-adjoint, okay. And now you compute. So these things don't commute. So the Y doesn't commute with M2 of C. Okay, they don't commute. So you form words. Okay, individually taken, they are nothing. 2x2 matrices is very discrete space, finite dimensional. So same for Y, it's nothing. But when you put them together and you write words and so on, what you find is 2x2 matrices of functions on the two spheres.
And no relation among the two.
No, the only relation is this relation, namely that the trace is zero. That's all. So when you compute with that, you find 2x2 matrices of functions over the two spheres. So what I am saying now is that it's simpler to define the algebra of 2x2 matrices of functions on the two spheres than the algebra of functions on the two spheres. Okay. What do you gain? Okay, you gain something which is quite amazing. What you gain is that the non-commutativity of the algebra now will give you the gauge fields automatically. Because when you will compute what are the metrics and what are called the inner fluctuations of the metrics? You see, the fact that the algebra is non-commutative gives you inner automorphisms. These inner automorphisms, when you compute what they are, in the case of matrices of functions, you find that they are exactly maps, smooth maps to the group SUN. And when you divide by inner automorphisms, you find the ordinary diffeomorphisms of the space. And moreover, when you do the same thing but for metrics, what you find is that the metrics now, they have the GMUs, but they also have new ingredients. And these new ingredients are exactly the gauge fields of gauge theory here for SUN. So in fact, what we asked with my collaborators, what we ask is, we ask a purely geometric question. The purely geometric question was the following. Is it possible to describe now four manifolds, not the two spheres? Okay? By such an equation, by such very simple presentation, okay. And we started from the analog of the relation which I had written there for the circle, which was a kind of Heisenberg relation. You see, this is very close to an Heisenberg equation, PQ and so on. And so we wrote an analog of this equation now in dimension n. Okay, we began to classify the solutions of this type of equation. And at first we were quite disappointed, because when we looked at this equation and classified the solutions, what we found is that it's only the sphere, or it's disjoint unions of spheres of unit volume. When you talk about physics, this size of the sphere will be the Planckian size. So at first we were disappointed, and we had found, you know, this type of bubbles. I mean, many, many, many little, very tiny little spheres. Okay, but then we realized that we had not any dimension n. Okay, here it's very general. Okay, but then we thought much more, and we found out that we should have involved a key ingredient of the story, which is because it's the nuance between K and KO theory. And it's very important, for instance, in the theorem of Sullivan. So then we wrote down, if you want, the KO refinement of this equation. And what we found out then is that for the KO equation, there was an infinitely better theorem. So there is this higher equation, which you don't need to know in detail. But what we found out for this KO equation to have solutions is that we needed two Clifford algebras, in dimension 4 we need two Clifford algebras which corresponded to, because it's a sphere, so to 5 pluses, and also the Clifford algebra which corresponded to 5 minuses. We needed both. Okay, so then we looked at the table of Clifford algebras. And what we found out is that by looking at this table of Clifford algebras, we got exactly the algebras that we had to put by hand to get the standard model coupled to gravity for in dimension 4. So the conclusion which I drew out of that is that, okay, somehow a purely geometric model, if you want to present the algebra of functions in the simplest possible manner, purely combinatorially, by using these symbols and these punctuation symbols, it gives you exactly the algebra that we had found from a bottom-up, if you want, story to get the standard model with the X, all these mechanisms, V minus C, and all this stuff. Okay, so we concluded from that that what
constants in the standard model.
How the constants enter? You see what you find. Now you have to use an action functional to get the standard model. This is spectral action that I'm going to discuss now. Okay, so what was the action? The dream was that the action in physics should only depend on the spectrum of the line element, so not on the space, but just on the spectrum of the line element. Okay, and this was confirmed because, you know, normally you write many GMUs, all sorts of notations, and so on and so forth. Okay, but it turns out that what we had found is that when you expand this function in terms of heat equation, you know, expansion and so on and so forth, you find several terms. And among these terms, I mean, there is a first a cosmological term, which is like lambda 4 times the volume. Okay, then there is a term lambda square times the Einstein-Hilbert action. Okay, plus the x square term. And then, plus when you look at the coefficient of lambda 0, you find the Young-Mills terms, the x quartic self-interaction. You find exactly what you need to find. Okay. But we were very bothered for a long time by this term, lambda 4 times volume, which is like a cosmological term because it's very huge. However, what the equation, what the Heisenberg equation does is to quantize the volume. So in other words, exactly as in the case of the circle, which I was describing here, where the length of the circle was 2 pi, it turned out that when you write this higher Heisenberg equation, the theorem is the following. The theorem is that in dimension 4 is critical. Because in order to get a solution, you need to cover the sphere in two ways, by two maps, in such a way that when you pull back the volume form of the sphere, and you add the two pullback, you get something which never vanishes. So for that, dimension 4 is critical. And the reason why dimension 4 is critical is that in general, you can get a ramified cover of the sphere which is ramified in a variety of dimension n minus 2 when you are in dimension n. But if you take two of them, then they will intersect, you know, they will intersect when this is n, okay, or less or equal to n. And this gives you n less than 4, exactly. And for n equals 4, it's very tricky, actually, to be able to do that. And it's not true for P2 of C, but it's true, amazingly, for any spin manifold. So for any spin 4 manifold compact, what you can do, you have this picture if you want. So what you can do is you can cover the sphere by two maps, and then because the cover can have multiplicity which is arbitrarily large, but it has to be at least 5 or something like that. Then if you want, what it means is that you can get a space whose volume now, whose size, if you want, will be very large in Planck units. Whereas, you know, if you couldn't get all these integers, you couldn't get something out of a sphere. You'd be stuck with a very small sphere. Okay, so now I come to the subject of my talk. Okay, which is really the spectral action. So spectral action, as I said, you know, it had a bothering cosmological leading term, but now this cosmological leading term is totally unimportant because the volume is quantized. So this is an integer. So the fact that the volume is quantized, that tells you that when you take the variational equations with respect to this action, you won't have this cosmological term anymore. Okay, it disappears.
Integer means positive integer.
So what? Positive integer, yeah. Integer positive. Okay, so the volume is positive integer. So we were not worried anymore about this. And then if you want the idea, the general idea, which will require a lot of work, of course, is that you know, one should see the geometry as emerging from the quantum. In other words, all of the stuff which I have explained, it's all operators in Hilbert space and so on. I didn't put a geometry by hand from the start. You know, I'm just looking at operator equations. Out of their spectra and so on emerges the geometry. So this is the idea. Okay, but now we come to this. You know, usually when you say that to physicists, they tell you, okay, fine, fine, fine. But what about the second quantization? Because what I have told you so far is really at the first quantized level, if you want. It's a story which is not taking quantum field theory and so on into account. Okay, it's a story. Of course, you know, it's very important that you have a good starting point. So I think we have a good starting point in order to recover geometry from the quantum. But okay, we need to understand how the second quantization will enter. Okay, and so as I said, you know, the fundamental problem is to understand at this point of the story, okay, which was several years ago, is to understand the role of second quantization. Now, this is the reason why I explained this stuff about K-theory and KO theory at the beginning, because you see, what has happened is that thanks to the index theorem, the dual of K-theory was known before, but the dual of topological K-theory did appear to bring with itself, you know, with the suitcases, the quantum, because the cycles were defined by representations in hyperspace and so on. Okay. Now, it turns out that there is a magnificent generalization of topological K-theory, which is the Quillen algebraic K-theory, and which is a theory which is quite more elaborate, if you want, and more difficult to define than the K-theory, than ordinary K-theory. And so far, nobody has developed what is the dual of the Quillen algebraic K-theory. In fact, in my inaugural talk in the Collège de France in 1985, I mentioned this as a fundamental question. Okay. And so we have, with my collaborators...
A dual like K-homology.
Exactly. You see, K-homology is dual to K-theory.
Yeah.
And what I believe is that the second quantization, quantum field theory, will be dual to Quillen K-theory. Okay? And I will give you some confidence for that. Okay? I had at
but
the
you
time...
You
yes.
expect it for every ring?
Well, okay, I mean, we are working over C. Okay. You see, I mean, okay, you could worry about non-Archimedean places, but we shall not do that today, okay? Today we are over the complex numbers. Okay, so the reason why this is very interesting is the following, is that you see the one characteristic property of the spectral action of this function is the fact that if you take two spaces which are disjoint, you take the disjoint sum of two spaces, then this functional will be additive, whatever function you take. And the reason is that, you know, the operator D will be the sum, like D1, direct sum, D2. So the function will be, you know, it will be like adding the trace in two different hyperspaces. So it will be obviously additive. So this additivity at a conceptual level is a key property. Now, there is another way to find an additive function of a spectral triple, which begins to look like second quantization. And what is it? So it's you take a spectral triple, okay, you take a spectral geometry, AHD, okay, and what do? Well, you think of the Hilbert space now as a real Hilbert space. So you take the underlying real Hilbert space to the Hilbert space H, so that's what I denote by H sub R. Okay, and so this is a Euclidean space, if you want. And to that space, you can assign a Clifford algebra, which if you want, now is much more congenial to the for Neumann algebras and so on. But I look at it as a C-star algebra. Infinite, of course, yeah.
So how you give algebra, you have to say
Poh, that? Topology, you take the norm, which is uniquely defined, by taking all unitary representations of the Clifford relations. Okay, so you see, you have vectors, you have gamma of xi for every vector here, and you have the relation that the gamma of xi square is equal to xi square. You take representations of that. Okay, and then if you take linear combination of these guys, or product and so on, you get a norm, because by taking... It's a C-star algebra. Okay, so C-star algebra, which is well known. This C-star algebra is in fact a co-limit of finite dimensional C-star algebras, because you can take, you know, finite dimensional subspaces. It will be the co-limit of these. And then it turns out, if you want, that the right way to think about it is the following, is that now we had the spectral triple. The spectral triple was spectral geometry. But now we think of it, we replace the Hilbert space by the Clifford algebra. Okay, so we replace the Hilbert space by the Clifford algebra in the middle. We replace the operator D now by a one-parameter group of automorphisms of the Clifford algebra. How is it done? Well, you see, I mean, the one-parameter group, sigma t, is a group which is corresponding by factoriality of the construction to exponential ITD. Okay? Exponential ITD, these are orthogonal transformations.
This sigma t is from coming from HR, automorphism of HR.
No, it's these are automorphisms of HR. Sigma t is automorphisms of Clif, okay? So sigma t are automorphisms of this Clifford algebra.
Which come from
the guy, okay, by functoriality, okay?
Yeah,
sorry? Yes, so what I'm saying is that this defines a group of orthogonal transformation of the underlying real Hilbert space. So I can view it as automorphisms of the Clifford algebra.
But where this group came is?
It came from the D in the spectral triple.
It
comes from the D. Okay. Now you can say where is the algebra playing a role? Well, the algebra does play a role. Sorry, the algebra does play a role. I mean, the algebra plays a role because you can, you know, the way the algebra was playing a role in the previous case is called the inner fluctuations of the operator D. So it's deformations of the operator D which come from the gauge potentials and all that. So this will deform this one-parameter group in the same way. So we have a way to second quantize our data, okay, our original data. Now we are going to use it. And we are going to use it because of the entropy, which is the von Neumann entropy. And the von Neumann entropy, which I will introduce very shortly, has a property that if you take a tensor product of two situations, type one, the entropy is additive. So the entropy of a tensor product is now the sum of the entropies. So this will recuperate the additivity of the spectral action, and it will tell us that when you compute the entropy of the corresponding second quantized stuff, it will give us a spectral action. Okay, so now I'm coming. Yeah. Entropy, okay. So entropy of what? So, okay. So we use this thing, okay? We have this one parameter group of automorphisms of the Clifford algebra. And so we have, if you want, the Clifford algebra and the one-parameter group. That's what we have, okay? We have this stuff. How do we get a state out of this? Well, by the KMS condition. So so the KMS condition is a condition which relates a one-parameter group of automorphism of a sister algebra with a state. And this for every value of beta, where beta is an inverse temperature. This state might exist, might not exist, might be unique, might be many. They form a convex set, I mean, and so on and so forth. Okay, there is a whole story about it. In this situation where we are, so this is the KMS condition. If you don't know it, forget it. I mean, it's a condition, if you want, which relates normally the state which is given by trace of e to the minus beta h with the Heisenberg evolution, which is given by ith dot e to the minus ith. So it's a condition that relates the time evolution with the state. But of course, this is a very simple case. In general, as I said, you know, on the sister algebra endowed with a one-parameter group of automorphisms, it might or might not exist. So here it turns out that in our situation, it's quite nice. It exists and it's unique. So if we take a complex Hilbert space, a self-adjoint operator with compact resolvent, we take the Clifford algebra, the complexified Clifford algebra of the real Hilbert space, and we take the corresponding automorphisms, then for any beta positive, there exists a unique KMS beta state. This is not difficult to show. Why? Because as I said, the Clifford algebra is a colimit of finite dimensional stuff. Now, the operator has discrete spectrum. So you can take the colimit according to the subspaces on which the operator is diagonal. Now you look in each of these spaces, it's a matrix algebra. And okay, and you have uniqueness of the KMS state. So this is not difficult. This is not difficult at all. Okay. Okay, so you could have a type 2-1 factor. You could have factors of various types. However, in our situation, where the operator has a property, where the Dirac operator is finite dimensional. So it has a property that if you want the resolvent, or 1 plus d squared to the power minus n over 2, will be a trace class. So this will be finite for a finite n. So because of that, Because of that, what happens in our case is that this operator turns out to be trace class. And then it turns out that the state that you obtain on the Clifford algebra is type 1. Okay? I mean, there are situations where it would be type 2, but here it's type 1. Okay? So the fact that it's type 1 allows us to use the von Neumann entropy. So what is a von Neumann entropy? If you take a type 1 state, you can always write the state in terms of a density matrix. Okay, so this is a von Neumann entropy. So this is what is a von Neumann entropy? So von Neumann entropy is the following. You take your state, you write it from a density matrix. So you write your state psi of an observable A is given by trace of rho times A, where rho is called the density matrix and normalized and what not. Okay, and it turns out then that the entropy is given by the von Neumann entropy of the state. So it's an information theoretic entropy. So the von Neumann entropy is given by minus trace of rho log rho. Okay, so this is definition. Fine. So this is where we stand now. So this is just, you know, the construction by what is called the Dirac C of the corresponding state. I mean, you know, this is standard stuff. This is standard stuff. Here is the entropy. So here is the definition of the von Neumann entropy. Okay. And now we apply this to our situation. We have a unique KMS state. It turns out to be type 1. So we can define its entropy. We can, by von Neumann. And we know, because of the fact that the entropy for a tensor product is the sum of the entropy, that it has to be a spectral action. But for which function? This is the issue. Okay? But we know a priori that it has to be the spectral action. Which function? So we compute. Okay? We compute. And what do we find? We find that because of this additivity, okay, it turns out that the function that we shall get, I mean, you know, first of all, let me use this notation, epsilon of x. This epsilon of x is the entropy of the partition for which the ratio of the sizes of the two intervals is equal to x. Okay, so it's the entropy of the rather easy thing where you have only two subsets, okay, and you assume that the ratio between the two lengths is x. So that gives you this stupid function, okay? And now what you do is there is the following theorem. So the following theorem is that now if you do the von Neumann entropy, you find that it's equal to the spectral action of beta d. So we have the spectral action. And this is the spectral function. It's h of x equals the previous function evaluated on e to the minus x. Okay. Now this is very simple. It looks very, very, very simple. And what was our surprise was to find the link between this and the Riemann zeta function. Okay, so this is really the mathematical content of the paper. Okay, and so what did we do to do that? Well, this is the function. First of all, it's a very good function, you know, because in the spectral action, you want the function to be positive, you want the function to decay very fast at infinity, and you want it to be a kind of cutoff function, but it shouldn't be a sharp cutoff because this would be bad. You want it to be smooth. So
that's epsilon of e minus x.
Yes, this is epsilon of e to the minus x. First of all, why is it an even function? Well, because if I change x to minus x, e to the minus x changes to the inverse. But I told you that this was the entropy when the ratio of the two intervals. So of course, I mean, you know, if I have two intervals and they have a ratio 10, if I exchange them, they will have ratio 1 over 10. So the function is even, okay? So that function is even, there is no problem. When you look at it a little bit more closely, this function, what do you find? You find that its derivative is actually without a log, and its derivative is given by this formula. It's given by minus x over 4, the hyperbolic cosine square of x over 2. Okay. And this is where things begin to be interesting. Because that function, you know, the function being, the function h being even, has to be a function of x squared and so on. So you have to be able to rewrite things in terms of x squared. So this is what you begin to do. You write this formula, okay? So now it's calculus, and it's a freshman calculus. So what you do is you write this formula. You can check this formula. This is not a big deal, okay? You check this formula with a sum over z. Begins to look like, you know, this one-dimensional kind of Eisenstein series. And then what you find out is that, you see, you would like to write your function as Laplace transform. Because then you can use the heat expansion to expand the various terms. So you begin to do that, but not for the function itself, for the piece of the function which was given by the square root. And what do you find? You find that this function g of t, because of this equality, is of this form. So it looks like a theta function. In fact, it is a theta function, very closely. Okay. In fact, so this function g of t turns out to be given by this formula. And this is extremely useful because you can use the you can use a modularity and to prove properties. So you use properties. And what do you get at the end of the day? You get that you can write the original function, the test function, which is forced on you by the entropy. You can write it as an integral from 0 to infinity of e to the minus t x squared. Very important to have x squared, because then we'll put d squared and we shall use the heat expansion. Of a certain test, I mean, of certain integration function, g tilde. And this function g tilde is trivially obtained from the previous. It's g of t over 2t. Okay. And so this allows you to go. Now, why we can go? We can go because precisely in the heat expansion, we can expand the trace of exponential minus t delta. Delta will be the square of this of d as a sum. Okay, as a sum, and it is exactly in these coefficients that are appearing the quantized volume, the Einstein-Hilbert action with the Higgs quadratic term, the Young-Mills terms, and so on. So we know that these terms are here, okay? We know that these terms are around, but now we want to know the coefficients. So we want to know, if you want, these integrals here. We want to know these integrals. And playing a little bit with these integrals, what do you find? You find that you write, you know, the usual formula for a power in terms of the gamma function, okay? And then you find out that actually you can rewrite the coefficients in the following form. Okay, so this is just a triviality. Okay, but then we have to compute it for our specific function. And when you compute it for our specific function, you get the following surprise. You get that the coefficient which will appear, for instance, in front of the Einstein-Hilbert action is zeta of 3. And for the zeta of 3, the coefficient which will appear in front of the volume is this one, with zeta of 5. And more generally, when you compute moments, okay, you begin to find this strange expression where this is a Riemann zeta function. Okay, okay. So then you begin to worry, because you see, it should be true that this integral should define, in fact, an entire function of alpha. So you begin to worry. You begin to worry about poles, about this, about that. Okay, so I mean, in the heat expansion, actually, this is a closed formula that you have. Okay, and so we begin to worry about this term.
Sorry? Where heat equation takes place?
Heat equation takes place because okay. Oh, in terms of the operator D, you see? As I said, the operator D.
It's heat expansion for this spectral geometry.
Right, sure. Yeah. It's from the spectral geometry. Yeah. Okay? And the operator D has in it not only the metric G mu, but all the gauge potentials and so on. So it will spit out exactly what you want. Which was very, very surprising at the very beginning, okay? So, but now we look at the coefficients, okay? We look at the coefficients, and this is the type of coefficients that we get, and we begin to worry about these coefficients, you know, because, as I said, it should be an entire function, so begin to worry about the poles and whatnot, okay? And you find out that there is no problem. It's really an entire function, and so on. You work with it for some time. You are worried, you know. I spent afternoons worrying because, okay, you don't know whether something might be wrong in the whole thing. Okay, and for instance, you have to have rationality when you look at the expansion, because the function h has only rational coefficients when you write down the expansion into a Taylor expansion, except for the first term. And what you find is that actually this is okay, because in zeta, the values of zeta at odd integers, at odd negative integers, are okay for that. So that's what you get. You get reassured. But finally, what you find is that the Xi function of Riemann appears. So the normalization, when you work in the coefficient of the heat expansion, A alpha, T alpha, will be the following. After many calculations, what we find is that it's given by this elementary coefficient, totally elementary, times the psi function of Riemann at 2 alpha. So typically, if you are in dimension 4, you will have a term like a minus 2 t to the minus 2 as the first term. Then you will have a term a minus 1 t to the minus 1, and so on and so forth. Okay, but with some coefficients, which are these gammas. And when you look at the table, when you look at the table which gives these gammas, this is what you find. So this is for dimension 4. This would be in dimension 3. This is the term corresponding to the Einstein term in dimension 4. And then you have the other term. Now, the very beautiful thing is the following. I will finish there. The very beautiful thing is that the functional equation of the psi function gives you a duality between the even dimensions and the even dimensions at large energy and the odd dimensions at low energy, and conversely. That's what it gives. So this will be the conclusion. Okay, so I mean, so we were extremely surprised, if you want. We were extremely surprised because somehow before, what was going on with this whole setup was that there was a freedom. I mean, there was no sort of, how to say, complete conceptual understanding of why we should take the spectral action. While now, just by touching from in a very mild manner with the second quantized theory, you find, you know, that there is beautiful interpretation of the spectral action, but for a very specific function. And of course, you know, now the name of the game will be to see precisely with respect to the constants of the standard model, you know, how this will fit. But there is, if you want, a freedom in this story. The freedom in this story is the spectral triple that you get for the finite space. So if you want, the general idea should be said as follows, that what this theory uncovers, it uncovers that it's probably wrong, and Riemann was right, to believe that when you go in the infinitely small, the structure is constantly the continuum. No, I mean, the structure is more subtle. It has some fine structure. And the beauty is that this whole fine structure is encoded by the line element, exactly as Riemann was saying. Because he was saying that the geometry should be specified by the forces, which actually hold the space together. That's exactly what is going on in this theory. Okay? Then, okay, I'm not really, you know, a physicist, so the issue is whether this understanding can be continued, can be continued really at the second quantized level. And what we are doing at the moment with Shamseddin and Seylekom, we have realized that the y, which was a Feynman slash of the coordinates, is actually a sigma model with values in a sphere. And these are rather well understood in physics. So this will give the quantization of this other side also, which is not present at the moment, if you want, which is totally, the type of second quantization I was discussing is very simple. You know, it's very, very simple. Okay, so I think I will finish here. let me now finish with the most important. Okay, yes, and you will see. I mean, it's a great time, you know, for the 60s. You will see.
Voilà. Est-ce qu'il y a des questions? Oui.
Yes. Yeah, the generalized Heisenberg equation. Yeah. You said this. Does it specify to the ordinary Heisenberg?
No. I mean, the PQ is very, very simple. The PQ would not allow you an arbitrary geometry. I mean, the beauty, if you want, of the equation which I wrote down is that the irreducibles are related to geometries. If you want, one difficulty with this quantum gravity, whatever, is that the geometry has to appear from some irreducible representation. Here it appears from irreducible representation of a very fancy, I mean, of this relation. It's very strange.
And what do you mean by the second quantization?
The second quantization, I mean the following. Okay, mathematically speaking, I mean the following. We replace the spectral triple, so the spectral geometry, by the Hilbert space is replaced by the Clifford algebra, the real one, okay? The operator, Dirac operator, is replaced by one parameter group of automorphisms, okay? And the algebra itself is manifest by the inner fluctuations, okay? Now, what would be great is if a mathematician or a physicist and so on would have the idea to develop this as not k-homology, but you know, algebraic k-homology, I don't know the name, okay? That would be dual to algebraic k-theory. And I know this is worthwhile because I knew for a long time, you know, that the, what are called the Schwinger terms in physics are dual to algebraic K2. So there is already some little hint, okay? But it's another story to develop the whole thing. I mean, this would mean, you know, that physics is teaching us what is really the geometry. It's much more subtle than we think. Of course, we are just starting, you know. So physics from the quantum is sort of trying to teach us what is the geometry. And it's very involved. Because so far, if you want the picture which I told you and so on, it's a one particle picture. It's not the full story, which is much more involved, for sure.
Votre question? Merci beaucoup.